the hot dog?
Are they going to need to go ahead?
Sunday we
Amen, amen, amen. The basics. You know, a soldier does basic training before they go into the fight. We've been in a fight. We having to go back to the basics. Amen, hallelujah. We're going to call up Pastor Jeff Pierce to give us a welcome and to give us a warm prayer.
Good evening, everyone. Praise the Lord tonight. I've been laying around in the bed today and praying and seeking God for the move of God in this city, in our state, in our country, in the world. You know, with what we see going on around us, it looks very bleak. But when Jesus is the center of it, there's joy and peace and love. I want y'all to know that we come in love tonight. Something the Holy Spirit spoke to me to me was to tell you that I love you no matter what you think, no matter who you are, that I love you. I appreciate you for being here. And God will bless you tonight in all that we do here. There's a scripture in Jeremiah 33:3. It says, call out to me. It says, call out to me and I will show you great and mighty things you never knew. Amen. God wants us to call out to Him today. He wants us to call out to Him in our problems, in our jobs, in our families, in our churches, in our walk, every day in life. Let's call on the Lord tonight. And let's usher Him into this place tonight. That the Spirit go up the streets. It goes out into the highways and the byways. And it compels them to come in the name of Jesus. Lord, we just thank you. Let's have prayer. Lord, we just thank you tonight for everything that you're doing. Everything that you've already got going on that we don't even know, Lord. We just honor you tonight with reverence and praise and worship. Lord, we come to praise you. We come to worship you tonight. Let the ears that are around us hear the joy of the Lord as we sing out, as we praise you, as we look to you in joy and peace. Lord, let each heart feel the peace of God in their life today. Let them know that there's something great taking place in our lives that we don't even know. I thank you, Lord. I honor you, Lord, tonight. With everything that we do here, that it be a blessing to others, and that they may receive something tonight, and that they would look to you and call out to you and know that you have something great for them in their lives, and that you are working in their behalf, no matter what we could ever think or do, that you're working out something for them, that the more they draw to you, the more you draw to them, and in that unity and love, and in that place with you, Lord, is where we get this peace and this joy that we so much seek for, Lord. Lord, have your way tonight. Touch each minister here. Touch each person that's came here tonight. Let them feel the presence of the Lord in their lives tonight. Let them know that something great is happening in their lives. But we just thank and praise you tonight, Lord, for all these things. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Sister Glenda Pearson from Sanford is going to honor us with a Spirit-filled song. Praise the Lord, saints. Praise the Lord. God is good all the time. This song is a part of my testimony. I always sing this song mostly everywhere I go. And we all know that we can make it.
Just as long as the Lord is on our side.
Amen.
Yes. Oh, keep promises. A shadow dreams. No hope is sweet. Still I believe
my blessed Savior. I'm going
Said, I give up this old world just to see him. Anybody wanna give up this old world just to see him?
Pearson, she's our gospelette singer from Santa. Her and her family's been singing for what? 29 years. November. Her family's been singing gospel music. Amen. Pastor Freeman?
All right, praise the Lord. You didn't think you'd get out of here tonight before we even had announcements. You got to have announcements at a church service. So we'd like to thank you all for accepting the invitation to be here. We pray that the Lord will touch you in a special way. There are masks and hand sanitizer. Thank you. For those wishing to use some of them, to use some at the food table as well, and there's some up there at the missions table. There's hot dogs, chips, popcorn will be served during the first hour. From 6 to 7 only, no refreshments will be served during the word. Water will still be available. Now, there's a table with resource material on top of the hill. For those who may need help gaining freedom from some type of dependence, there's a free Bible-centered 12-step program there. There's a program here in Carthage, and Simple Truth Ministries can give you information on how to sign up. And also, if you'd like to make a donation to help cover the food and other costs, there's a bucket up there at the missions table. So, and Noah's passing the offering plate. We do this free of charge and just give God the glory. Praise the Lord. Where's Donna at? Oh, yes, there's a communion table up there. I didn't see that in the announcements, but if you want to do communion at any time during the service, there's going to be somebody up there for you to take communion. And they'll walk you through it.
Praise the Lord. Okay, so I'm Donna Mann. That guy at the top of the hill at that table is Robert Mann. And we are the overseers of the Gathering Revival Center. And that is located next to Buggy Town Coffee on South McNeil Street in Carthage. Robert and I have information up there for you. And we have a sign-up sheet as well. So we're looking to recruit some testimonies. We take pastors, musicians' testimonies, and we also do have a 12-step program we'll be happy to give you information about. If you will stop by that table up there, we'll sign you up and give you some information, okay? God bless, and I'm so glad that we're having this revival. Y'all be blessed.
Pastor Kathleen Yakovich is going to get up and give a testimonial word of encouragement.
Hi,
Hi, everybody. I don't know how much of a testimony or encouragement it'll be from me, but I will give you a testimony that'll be encouraging from the Lord. So, I'm just going to tell you for a few minutes how I came to be a missionary to Africa, and why would a 78-year-old woman be planning to go out to Africa again as soon as the doors open? And I was called to Africa when I was 9 years old. And I wondered all my life, till I was 32, how could that happen? I was scared to death. There's no way I was going to some foreign land, some third world country, and be a missionary for the Lord. And Africa especially, right? And so the Lord started sending me out on all kinds of missions. I think my first one was to England. And then there were several others, four to the Philippines, and there was two to El Salvador. I actually did some mission trips to Texas, and I can't remember that other state we went to, but we went, Diana and Jeff and I, and we did some little bit of mission work there. But we did do things in the United States as well. And I kept wondering, when, Lord, am I going to go to Africa? When is this going to happen? I've had all these other places, and believe me, I wasn't too keen about going out there into a third world country. I wasn't going out there because I wanted to go out there. I was going out there because I knew the Lord wanted me to go out there. And so that is why I still go. It doesn't thrill me to go into a third world country where all my creature comforts are non-existent. No hot water sometimes. No amenities, no electricity sometimes. You know, until it gets off periodically, they might get four hours of electricity in a day, and the rest of the day may have nothing. that was just not my idea of being in the comfort zone. Now, I'm here to tell you, serving the Lord doesn't happen in your comfort zone. It happens in the most uncomfortable place. And so the only thing I can tell you about how or why a 78-year-old woman would go out there to Africa to do mission work is just pure love. The love of God. You gotta love God more than you love yourself. You gotta love God more than you love anybody else on the face of the earth. You gotta love God to the point that you know you could walk away from family, friends, and acquaintances and die for the Lord in the mission field. When you get there, that's a good place to be. And I can't say that I got there right away. I'll tell you, in the Philippines, I was there for about 3 days, and I was scared out of my mind, and I had an open ticket, and I turned around and came right back home. So it doesn't happen overnight. And don't expect miracles of yourself. Just get out there and do it. You love what it does for you and your relationship with God. You'll love it. Thank you.
The ministry that has so graciously came to assist with the sound and with the praise and worship is Refresh My Spirit Ministries out of West End. And we're so thankful and grateful that they wanted to be a part of what we're doing tonight and what we're doing for the next 2 days. We'd like to call them to come forward. And until it's time for the word, they're going to bring in the worship. Refresh My Spirit Ministries.
Plug your guitar up, hit one. Mac, on the board. Hit your mute group, it'll unmute all of you. Right there, come here.
So good. Who's glad to be here this evening? I said, who's glad to be here this evening? God is so good. You know, we got a lot to think about. We got a lot to pray about. You know, they had over there in Oregon, they had started something like this over there in Oregon, and Antifa came in and they knocked down everything they had. Tore it all to pieces. And you know what came out of that? There was a multitude of people came. So do not despise small beginnings. And when the enemy comes in roaring like a lion, trust me, victory's on its way. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. God is so good. Know sweet your name. Hallelujah. God is so good. Hallelujah. praise his holy name. Come on now, put your hands together. We stand and lift up our hands for the joy of the Lord is our strength. How many believe it? We bow down and we worship him now. How great, how awesome is he? Sing it again. We stand and lift up our hands.
Yeah.
For the joy of the Lord is our strength.
We bow down.
Worship him now. How great, how awesome is he? Together we sing now. Together we sing.
All the world chorus, come on, church.
Everyone sing. Holy the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. Holy the Lord. The earth is filled with his glory. Lord, we praise you now.
We praise you, O God. Hey, one more time. Come on and sing it, church.
We stand and lift up our hands. For the joy of the Lord is our strength.
Yes, you are, O God.
Worship it now. How great, how awesome is he?
Together,
together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God. The earth is filled with his glory. The earth is filled with his glory. The earth is filled with his glory.
One more time.
The earth is filled with his glory.
Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah.
You know in God's word it says he inhabits the praises of his people. My question is, are you his people? And if you are, going, just let him have his way in this place. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, oh God. Hallelujah. How many of you are set free tonight? We're going to do something a little different for you. And I'm going to sing a song for you. He set me free in 1988, folks. I was 19 then. You don't have to do no ad or anything. But you know what? I was young then, and I thought I was going to give up a lot of things. But you know what? I've gained so much more. And she's going to do it for us. Okay, ready? Here we go.
Jesus came and listened to
little hard to pick up the oxygen. Yes. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. God is so good, folks. I thank you for the privilege for letting us come out and just worship God. Ain't you worthy? Ain't you worthy? You know, we don't have no time to be carnal Christians anymore. We don't have no time to be laid back Christians anymore. We don't have no time to be lukewarm, cold, and indifferent. For he said in his word, he said he'd rather have you hot or cold, didn't he? He said, if you're lukewarm, what'd he say? He said, he'd spew you right out of his mouth. You know, all the things that we do for the Lord, if we're not living by God's word, all we're doing is in vain. We're trusting in him. I don't want to be in front and say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I never knew you. I want to hear him say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the joys of the Lord. Hallelujah. He's going to prepare us for a place, folks. Hallelujah. But where he is, we shall be also. Amen. Glory to his holy name. God is so good.
This joy.
Goodness. I am
about to have my fourth baby, and all three of those over there are mine as well. But when I was pregnant with my youngest, Phoenix, we were in a really bad car accident, and we were getting ready for our baby shower. I think this was on a Friday, and our baby shower was on a Saturday. Well, it was really dark at night, and we were in Aberdeen, right there where Ruby Tuesdays is, the intersection, and it was my husband and I and our two older kids now in the car, and we were having such a good night. You know, that's just how the devil works, though. You know, like, he just tries to ruin everything. We were having a really good night, and we were getting ready to go over the intersection because I had to go get my makeup for my baby shower. And all of a sudden, I felt this overwhelming feeling of awkwardness. That's the only way I can describe it in that moment. And I was about to look at my husband and ask him, "Do you feel kind of awkward too?" Because I do. And I went to say something to him, but then something told me to look in my window, and there were headlights. So we got hit, and they had to use the jaws of life, I think that's what it's called, to get me out. I went into preterm labor with my youngest, and I don't cry because I'm sad anymore. I'm thankful for what God has done for me. Told that my baby probably wouldn't make it if he were to be born, so they kept trying to stop the labor, and I was hospitalized every week for about 3 or 4 days at a time, and I was in so much pain, but I finally ended up having Phoenix, and he was shaken and non-responsive, so they took him away from me and put him in NICU, and they told me, "This is probably the last time you'll see your son." And I said, "No, I'm not receiving that. I serve a big God." And I just remember feeling so defeated in that moment, but also trying to remember how big my God is and how much of a miracle worker He is. And I got to my hospital room after I delivered him, and I just fell to my knees beside the bed. And a mother's prayer is, please just don't take my baby away from me, Lord. Just don't. I'm begging you. And the doctor ended up coming back into the room and telling me that if he were to survive, he'd have a lifelong condition, breathing problems, along with other things. And I said, "No, but God. And I just kept repeating that to myself over and over and over again, and I ended up going to church one morning. It had been a little bit since I had went, but when I got to the church, I got a phone call that Phoenix wasn't, every time they took him off the oxygen, he just dropped, like, it just wasn't working, and he wasn't eating. The situation wasn't getting better, but I kept telling myself, I serve a big God, and I know that God hears my prayer. And I said, "God, even if it's not what I want your will to be done in this situation." So I had sung a song to Phoenix every time I went into the NICU, and it was called Healer. And every time I sung it to him, I was holding him, he would smile at me. And so that morning, I got up on the church stage, and I just gave it all to God. And I kid you not, as soon as I walked off that stage and I got into the foyer of the church, I got a phone call. Now, you tell me that God is not a big, that we don't serve a big God, because the person that called me was his NICU nurse. And she told me that he was being taken off of oxygen because he could breathe completely on his own. He was eating perfectly, and he'd be coming home in a couple of days. Phoenix is going to be 4 in December, and there is absolutely nothing wrong with him. He is happy. He is healthy. And I just thank God, and I praise God. I get up here, and I close my eyes, and I just worship, because God deserves all of me. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's not about anybody but God. And I'm going to continue to do that till I take my last breath. So I just wanted to share that little bit of a testimony with you. I'm sorry I'm so out of breath. My baby's so big I can't breathe. So, yeah.
So, there are decisions we have to make in our lives. You ready, brother?
Yes.
Hallelujah, Lord. My sound man over here, also my son-in-law. I love my son-in-law. I didn't lose a daughter, I gained a son. How'd that sound? It's awesome. He's an awesome man of God, I love him. She said, sing that song again. And I said, okay. And it's called Healer in the House. I'm talking about Jesus. There's a healer in the house. So listen to this song here that my wife loves. And she was an inspiration to this song. Because it ministers to her as well as it ministers to me. I'm going to do a couple more for you. There's a healer in the house. There ain't no doubt. He'll meet you out of where you are. Is the trouble in your land? Things seem so out of hand. And you're looking for a way out. Guess what, church? There's a healer.
Turn from the wicked ways, and they will hear.
Hallelujah, Lord. I want to do this song here for you before the preacher comes up and starts preaching tonight. I want you to sing with me, okay? My voice is a little low. I'm going to give Amber a little break here. Maybe she can sing with me.
We could hear with our physical ears what those angels are singing right now. We can hear it in the spirit. But there's going to come a day when we're going to be with them. And when we sing those beautiful words, holy, 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 those words will mean something entirely different there than they meant here. We just can't wait for that day. We're going to read a passage of Scripture. We're going to say a prayer. We're going to begin our message. This passage of Scripture is taken from Philippians chapter 2. And we're going to begin, actually we're going to read the first 11 verses of this chapter. The word says, therefore, and of course this is from the New King James, in case you wonder. Therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Our Heavenly Father, we lift up those spoken words from your word. We pray, Father, that as we lift these words up to you in worship and praise, that you will not let it return without it fulfilling its purpose. We thank you, Father, for the opportunity we have to expound in your word. And we pray, Father, that as this word amplifies through this neighborhood, through this city, through the hearts of those who are here and listening to it, that it will indeed do what you have purposed. We pray, Father, that you will anoint the mouth of the speaker and the ears of those who will listen. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. There was a city boy that had never been on a farm before. And he asked the farmer, "Mister, why doesn't this cow have any horns?" The farmer cocked his head for a moment, then began a patient tone. "Well, cattle can do a powerful lot of damage with their horns. Sometimes we keep them trimmed down with a hacksaw. Other times we can fix up the youngins by putting a couple drops of acid where their horns could grow. Still, there are other breeds of cattle that never do grow horns. But the reason this cow doesn't have no horns is 'cause it's a horse." You would think that even a city boy would know the difference between a horse and a cow. But then you would also think that a Christian would know the difference between true Christianity and what a lot of folks think is Christianity. In this passage, Paul is telling the Philippian church what Christianity should look like. But what he is describing doesn't come naturally to a lot of people. In fact, there are many in churches across the land who still don't know what true Christianity looks like. Do you know why? Primarily, it is because Christians are simply not acting like Christians. They may have a beautiful building, they may have a dynamic preacher, but they could not tell a horse from a cow when it came to Christianity, because they are more a follower of their religion than they are of Christ. What denomination was Christ? What denomination was the Apostle Paul, Peter, or John? Why do we have so many denominational belief systems? It is not because of the primary doctrines of Scripture. The primary doctrines are the fundamental beliefs that unite the entire body of Christ. It is the primary doctrines that separate the truth from the heresy and the wheat from the tares. Just very quickly, what are some of these primary doctrines? Well, there's two of them found in the book of Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10 verse 9. Says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Amen. That is two doctrines right there. The doctrine of the confession of Jesus as Lord and the doctrine of the resurrection. Amen. If you do not confess Jesus as your Lord, you can't really say you're a Christian. And if you do not believe that Jesus died and on the third day rose, you have no foundation for what you believe. There's two more found in Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Acts chapter 2. Verse 38. Those were the words of Paul. Here are the words of Peter. It says, then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now the two doctrines that you see there are the doctrines of repentance and the doctrines of baptism. Supporting scriptures for what Peter said, or one is found in Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, verse 46 to 47. It says, then he said to them, thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. Notice verse 47, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Why aren't the churches preaching repentance now? They'd rather preach a feel-good message. It's not a feel-good message. Repentance is a sorrowful message that moves our heart to make a change and to get closer to God. Matthew 28, 19 and 20 is the other support scripture. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things that I have commanded you. And look, I am with you all the days until the end of the age. There you have it. Jesus himself preached baptism. Now you may sit here and say, well, Pastor, the evildoer that was next to Jesus on the cross, he didn't get baptized and he was saved. That's true. Look at his circumstances. Do you think that that evildoer, if he could have jumped off that cross and went to a baptismal pool, he would have? Of course he would have. There are people today who their circumstances will not allow them to get into the baptismal pool. Someone who's in an iron lung or someone who is in some type of disability. Jesus knows the circumstances. But if our circumstances afford it, should we not be obedient to his command? Again, that is a primary doctrine. A fifth primary doctrine that I'm going to highlight tonight is found in John chapter 14, verse 6. John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said this to doubting Thomas. How many doubting Thomases we have here tonight? Hopefully none. But it's okay if you doubt a little bit. You just need more knowledge. John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one. Let me say that again. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the doctrine of the exclusivity of Christ. This is supported by something that Peter said in Acts chapter 4, verse 12. And it's supported by other passages of Scripture. But Peter said it, I think, best when he said it this way. Nor is there salvation in any other. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. That right there is a fundamental truth of Christianity. And there's only one way. There's only one truth. And there is only one life. Only one. It isn't in Buddha. It isn't in Muhammad. It's not in Krishna or Vishnu. It isn't in any Judaic religion. It's not in any hybrids of Christianity. Jesus does not mix with anyone or anything else. Study what Paul said in the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 2 for further support. The exclusivity of Christ is a primary doctrine that defines true Christianity. Now those are just five basic doctrines that define a Christian. Now there's sub-doctrines of some of these. We talked about baptism. There's several different doctrines of baptism. We even talked about what is said in the name. Are you baptized in the name of Jesus or in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? Those again are more doctrines. Those are what we call sub-doctrines. There's also secondary doctrines. Now this is the one that touches us. These secondary doctrines are doctrines like Calvinism, Arminianism, baptism of the Holy Spirit and exercise of the gifts, doctrine of unconditional eternal security. There are third point doctrines, such as our view of different views of hell. There's three Christian views or biblical views of hell that people believe in. The one most common to our area and to most of us is eternal torment. But there's also the view of universal reconciliation and annihilationism. But then what's really got people excited because of the times we're living in is all the different doctrines that are associated with eschatology. You know what eschatology is? The study of end times. Are you premillennial? Are you amillennial? Postmillennial? In that segment, you have pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, and even a fourth one called pre-wrath trib. That's where the church is raptured in the final quarter of the tribulation. Now, there are many more doctrines that I could spend days researching and talking to you about. But here's the key. Those are secondary doctrines. Third point doctrines. Those are doctrines that don't really define if we're Christian or not. So why waste the time debating and arguing about who's right and who is wrong? I don't have time to talk of these, and you probably don't have time to listen to it. Are these secondary doctrines proof of your salvation? What are these secondary doctrines? They are simply interpretations of secondary teachings that are believed with the most sincerity. These are the teachings that have been a part of our families for generations. And we hold these things dear. These are not the various teachings that entered the church and brought apostasy. The teachings that accomplished that are basically the teachings that are opposite of the primary doctrines. The teaching that you can have other gods and lords of your life. The teaching that Jesus was not raised from the dead. The teachings that you can live as you please and don't have to repent because Jesus forgave you in advance for any sins you may could commit. You know what they call that? Antinomianism. No law. You have no law of Christ over you. And it's associated with the broad mercy doctrine. The teachings that there is no mandate for baptism, that that's just a waste of time and you don't have to get your hair wet. As well as the teachings that God is so big that he can be in every religion and that all roads lead to heaven. That breaks my heart. I know of a family that was in ministry for years. And the grandson who took over the quote unquote family business decided that he was going to open up an inclusive church. And in his sanctuary was a cross, a Star of David, a Hindu symbol, a Shinto symbol, an Islamic symbol, any major a Buddhist symbol. And his teaching is that all God is in all of it. Has it right there in his sanctuary. It's called inclusivism. That breaks my heart. Because if you believe in inclusivism, you're basically saying that Jesus Christ lied. He said there was no other way to the Father except through him. There are other gospels that have entered the church. I'm not going to elaborate on them, but they're there. I'm sure some of our other speakers may elaborate on some of them later. There are cult-like groups and sects that have brought in destructive teachings that hurt the church and have led many astray. Those are the doctrines that was prophesied in Scripture that would come against the church and hurt the church. But let me be clear. The basic primary doctrines do not divide the Christian denominations. It is the secondary and third doctrines that define what denominational belief system that you believe in that you are a part of. It is the primary doctrines that unite us in one body, one faith, and one baptism. It is the primary doctrines that make a Baptist, a Methodist, a Presbyterian, a Lutheran, a Wesleyan, a Pentecostal, a Mennonite, a Quaker, or any mainstream denomination or independent church. It is the primary doctrines that we share that unites us as brothers and sisters in Christ. We are covered in the same blood, and we all have the same hope. There's absolutely no reason for our differences in opinion in secondary and third doctrines to cause us to segregate and divide from other members of the body of Christ. We can maintain our belief in these, but as encouraged in this revival, we should go back to the basics and the primary things. The primary things that unite us with one another. Is that not what Jesus Christ would want us to do? All members of His body should be united. Again, I ask, what denomination was Paul? What denomination was John or Peter? You want to know the answer to that? The very same one who believes in the primary doctrines today, which includes most mainstream denominations. Go back to the basics. Now let's go back to the passage that we read earlier. I like to expound on the word. Philippians chapter 2, verse 2. Let's look at this passage through the lens of what we just taught. That we are all one in Christ, regardless of what church or what denomination that we are a part of. Look at this passage in that same lens. Verse number 2. Fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Did you catch the emphasis here? Same mind, same love, full accord, which means agreement. This doesn't mean denomination. Being of the same mind is not talking about secondary doctrine stuff. It's talking about whose mind? The mind of Christ. That's what Christianity should look like. And whenever Christians of various denominations live together like that, there is a powerful atmosphere of joy and excitement and unity. But too often, Christians don't look or act like that, even in their own denomination or even in their own church. Let me tell you some stories. They might be a little humorous to you, but they're kind of sad. There was a story of a church that argued about what color of shingles to put on the roof of the church building. Some of them wanted red shingles and others wanted green shingles. And they actually got into quite a heated argument over it, but eventually they compromised. Oh, how dear is that? They decided to shingle one half of the roof with red shingles and the other half with green shingles. And get this, from that day forward, the half that wanted red sat under the red shingle side, and the half that wanted green sat under the green shingle side. Was that a church or a daycare? On a more serious note, some years ago, there was actually a split in a Dallas church. Lawsuits were actually filed to determine who should own the property. The judge referred the case back to their denomination to handle it. And during the hearing, the church courts discovered that the conflict had begun years before at a church dinner when a certain elder was served a smaller piece of ham than the child who was seated next to him. That one incident led into years and years of division, to where now it was time to take themselves to court. Isn't there a scripture about that? Take themselves to court to determine who should get the church. Can I repeat something I said earlier? Christians sometimes don't behave like Christians. Now God knew that was going to happen. He knew it. He knew people would have a hard time living up to that standard. He knew we would have difficulty being of one mind and one love, and there's a reason why there was going to be this situation. As Romans chapter 3, verse 23 tells us, does anyone know that by memory? We've all sinned. And do what? fall short of the glory of God. Every Christian in church has come out of a sinful mindset, and there are times they have a hard time leaving that sinful character behind. That's why Paul wrote the stuff that he did in the book of Philippians. Now, if we understand what Paul was telling us here, if we decide to pick the prescription he sets forth in this passage, then we will be of one mind and have one love. And then we'll look like Christians. What's the prescription? Let's go back to verse 3. Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 5. I'm going to emphasize some words here. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interest of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. In other words, the problem is selfishness. It's ambition. It's conceit. It's looking out for my own interest first that leads to problems not only in the body, but in our individual churches too. That is how a horse ends up looking like a cow in church. But as we emphasize, notice the highlighted phrases. It's those things that can make us look, the things here that we're told to do, like in humility, count others more significant than yourselves. That's, now this is the next verses. Let me just read it. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but to the interest of others. See, it's those things that make us look like real Christians. Now notice what Paul's saying here. It's okay to look out for your own interest. It's okay to do that. You've got to supply for your family. You've got to pay your bills. You've got to take care of your home. You've got to take care of your health and your body. It's okay to do that. But what happens too often is that is what Christians mostly focus on. Themselves. And other Christians in the church come in a distant second. And the people across the street in the other church, they don't come in at all anywhere. Just to help us understand this, let me tell you a story of two fourth grade classes. In both classes, the teachers introduced a game called Balloon Stomp. A balloon was tied to every child's leg. The object of the game was to pop everyone else's balloon while protecting your own. The last person whose balloon hadn't been popped one. In the first class, when the teacher said, go, these kids got into the game. A flurry of activity, shouting filled the room as kids stomped on each other's balloons. A few of the children clung to sidelines like wally flowers at a middle school dance. But their balloons were doomed just the same. The entire battle was over in just a few seconds, and the worst person, the most unliked individual, the one who was rude and pushy and offensive, of course, he's the one that won. Doesn't sound like too much fun, does it? There was a second class that was introduced to this same game. But the class was made up of mentally handicapped children. Perhaps the instructions were given too quickly for them to grasp. But the one idea that these kids got from it was this, that the balloons had to be popped. But they approached the game different than the first class. Instead of fighting each other, they began to help each other pop their balloons. One little girl knelt down and held her balloon carefully in place while the little boy stomped it flat. Then he knelt down and held his balloon for her to do the same. It went on like this, not for a few seconds, but for a few minutes. And at the end, everybody cheered because everybody won. Now, aside from their mental abilities, what was the difference? Well, the first class saw the game as, this is my balloon, and they sought to look out for their own interest. The second class saw the game as, we have to win. And so they sought to look out for everyone's interest. It wasn't about me. It was about we. And that's what Paul was talking about here. Paul didn't just stop there. Notice what he said. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even to the death of the cross. Now there's two things here. First, Paul was telling us that we need to copy Jesus. The more that we all become like Jesus, the more we'll be of the same mind and of the same love. You see, too often church people are like this. They're in conflict with each other. Because one person wants it that way and the other person wants it this way. But once we put Jesus in the mix and we begin to copy Jesus, we begin to decide what we want with what He wants. And as we start getting closer to Him, we notice we start getting closer to our brother. Let me illustrate this. Anybody knows what a triangle looks like? You got two points at the bottom that are further apart from each other, right? That's you and your Christian brother or sister. Who's at the top point? Jesus. Well, here you are thinking the way you do, and they're thinking the way they are. They're separated. But the more that they come together to try to think like Jesus think, what happens? What happens? When you take on the mind of Christ, and your brother takes on the mind of Christ, now the two of you have the same mind. Now you are together. The second thing I saw here when I looked at that passage that we just read in 6 verse 6 through 8. Paul was letting us know who was in charge at church. You see, most church problems and divisions arise from a thinking that reminds me of an old Beatles song. How many baby boomers we got here tonight? Okay? Forgive me right now in the name of Jesus for singing a secular song in the pulpit, but I have to make a point. Think of what you're saying. You can get it wrong and still you can think that it's all right. Think of what I'm saying. We can work it out and get it straight or say goodnight. We can work it out. We can work it out. Life is very short and there's no time for fussing and fighting, my friend. I have always thought that it's a crime. So I will ask you once again, try to see it my way. Only time will tell if I am right or I am wrong. While you see it your way, there's a chance that we may fall apart before too long. We can work it out. We can work it out. You know what that song is saying? It's saying we can work it out if you see it my way. I'm right, you're wrong. And if you insist on your way and reject my way, there's a chance that we may fall apart before too long. You see, it's a power struggle issue. A struggle over my rights to have my way. Or the right to say that I or my church are the only ones who are right. But then this Jesus thing gets in the way. He who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. Now Jesus was God. That's another doctrine. Jesus was God. But he didn't use his godhood as an excuse to be superior, even though he was. Instead, he emptied himself. He became a servant. What rights does a servant have? None. Jesus surrendered his rights, and now he expects us to learn how to do the same. So if I want to follow Jesus' example, I will empty myself of my rights, and my major focus will be on helping you get your way. I'll focus on making you successful. I'll try to help you meet your dreams and goals at church. Why? Because that's exactly what Jesus did. Jesus took the form of a servant. Being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. He died. Why? Why did he humble himself unto death? He died to remove our guilt and our shame. Jesus died for us. And you know what he expects us to do? To die of ourselves. Rob Frazier wrote a song. I'm not going to sing this one. It goes, hear the words. Listen to these words. Dead people don't mind the pain. Don't get offended, so they never complain. They're not concerned about personal gain. Does that sound like me or you? The truth is rising from the midst, and the word is this. That when Jesus calls a man, he calls him to come and die. He doesn't want you better. Jesus wants you better. That's exactly what Jesus said earlier in his ministry. What did he tell his disciples in Matthew chapter 20? Matthew chapter 20, verse 25 to 28. Jesus called them to himself, and this is what he said. You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who are great exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus is our example of how to become servants. Jesus came not to be served, but to serve and to die and to become our ransom. Insofar as we imitate him, and insofar as we strive to be servants of others, that will be the foundation of the entire body of Christ, being of one mind and being of one love. But the key thing to remember is that it all starts with me. It all starts with you. If you and I become an example of servanthood, then we can help others become better servants for Jesus. And the world will then take notice. Allow me to start to close this sermon with an illustration about a mother. She had this little son named Lynn. This is her word. She said, Lynn, who was 3 at the time, was on my heels no matter where I went. Whenever I stopped to do something and turned back around, I would trip over him. Several times I patiently suggested fun activities to keep him occupied. Would you like to play on the swing set? I asked again, but he simply smiled, an innocent smile, and he said, oh, that's all right, Mommy. I'd rather be here with you. Then he continued to bounce happily along behind me. After stepping on his toes for the 5th time, I began to lose my patience. I insisted that he go outside and play with the other children. When I asked him why he was acting this way, he looked up at me with a sweet green eyes grin and he said, "Mommy, in primary, my teacher told me to walk in Jesus' footsteps, but I can't see him, so I'm walking in yours." That mother learned the value of being a Jesus role model for her son. In the very same way as we imitate Jesus, we become role models for others, and ultimately we can help build the body of Christ into a place of one mind and one love. But this cannot happen unless we let go of our differences and let go of our presuppositions. I'm not suggesting we dismantle our churches and denominations. Absolutely not. What I'm suggesting is that we do not allow the fact that we interpret a certain teaching differently to cause us to withhold unity, to withhold love, and to withhold fellowship. Go back to the basic doctrines, the primary doctrines. Go back to the basics and show the world and show the devil that we are all part of the body of Christ and that no weapon formed against us will prosper. We have an enemy that is raging against us across the globe. That enemy martyred our brothers and sisters in the underground church in Afghanistan just last week. That enemy came into our courthouses and schools across America years ago and took the Ten Commandments and the prayer out of both. That enemy last year closed most of the churches down for weeks. Most churches did not even have an in-person Easter service. That enemy has been raging mad for the last 40 or 50 years against the unborn. Texas got a victory last week regarding their strict abortion law. But our enemy is working through the Justice Department right as we speak to allow parts of that law to be ignored for those who wish to murder their babies. This enemy is seen, but it gets its power and it gets its drive from the unseen realm. It is an antichrist spirit that wishes to kill, steal, and to destroy humanity. Why? Why? Because the devil knows his days are short. He knows that Jesus has the victory. But if the devil can't distract, detour, and to destroy most of the Christians, if he can accomplish that, then the devil will assume that he really won and that Jesus' blood was in vain. That is why the devil is relentless. That is why he doesn't stop. That is why he is using the same powers of this world to attack the foundations of Christianity. We cannot allow the devil to weaken us with divisions of secondary doctrine. We must, for the sake of Christ, go back to the basics. Let's show the devil and the world that Christians will stay united in spite of the devil's efforts. United we stand, divided we fall. If we stand together, if we fight together, if we move together, then we will see our deliverance together. We will dwell with him together. And we will share eternity together. It all starts with the basics. It all starts with the basics. That simple. The basics. One faith. One baptism. One dedication to Christ. To Christ. Not a church or a church building. To Christ. The basics. If there's anyone here who agrees with a lot of what I just said, or hopefully all of what I've said, why don't you come down here and let's have an altar prayer. Let's have an altar prayer right now. If you feel comfortable to do so, grab your neighbor's hand. I understand some, because of COVID, may feel uncomfortable, but that's... If anybody has fear, you don't have to do it. I'm going to still pray through the microphone so that those upstairs can hear me. Father, I lift up every spoken word here tonight to you. And I know that your people who were called by your name has disappointed you. We haven't stood for what was right in the sake of trying to keep peace with the Antichrist spirit. We haven't spoken out when we should have. We have sat and we've allowed things to go on in the church without church discipline. We brought reproach upon your name because of it. And right now in this altar, we repent. We ask, Father, that you forgive us. We ask, Father, that you forgive us. That we did not preach more against the killing of these babies. That should be something we preach every time we come together. Because that is a sacred life to you. Forgive us, Father, for the times when we claimed that we had your name, but we didn't live and act as if we had it. We repent, Father. And Father, I pray that this prayer will echo throughout every city in America.
Right.
Because this country must come to its knees.
Right.
Fall to their knees and before your face.
Right.
And seek your face.
Right.
And humble ourselves. And Father, we know you have the power to heal this land.
Right.
We know ultimately it will be healed when Jesus cracks that sky. But Father, we know that we disappointed you, and for that we ask forgiveness.
Yes, Lord.
We ask forgiveness for the divisions we've had amidst the different denominational issues we've had. Father, we pray that the Baptist and the Methodist and the Pentecostal and the Lutheran and the Wesleyan, we pray that all these churches can come together. They can have revival together. Yes. To go on the basic doctrines of what we all believe in. And that is that Jesus Christ was crucified, and on the third day he was raised, and in that he gave us a new life.
Yes. Hallelujah.
That is the message.
Thank you, Lord.
Nothing else could divide us. Help us to concentrate on this, Father. Help us in the name of Jesus to come together and to be a light that is not only shining, but a bright light. We need to first lighten up our churches so that we can go forward in the world and light it up. We pray for your power. We pray for your help. We pray, Father, that you give us the strength and the courage. Some of us may not have boldness to do what we're praying about. But we know that you will mount us up with wings like eagles. And we will run. We will not tire out. We will not grow weary. We will stand our enemy in the face. And we will declare that Jesus Christ is our victory. And in his name, the strong tower, every principality and every evilness will bow. We need that power. We need that strength. We need it, Father. And because power is one of your great attributes, we call on you to supply our need. Bless every soul that has been here tonight. Bless the ones who will come tomorrow, the ones who will come the following day. Give us strength, Father. Give us encouragement. I pray that the broadcast will reach many, and the ones that are local who see it will want to come back tomorrow or come here tomorrow. We're praying, Father, not because of some numbers game. It's not about numbers. It's about more souls hearing the truth of your word and uniting together in it. And showing to this community and in actuality to the world through the broadcast that we stand with Christ and that what the devil's trying to do is not working with us. Our victory is in Jesus. And we will continue to march on. We will continue to rise. We will continue to be faithful, even if it means our life. We pray that you will give us the strength, the courage, to have the same strength and courage that our dear brothers had last week when they came under the Taliban attack. We know they have a greater victory. And we know that our brothers will be with Jesus when he brings the judgment upon every defilement that has come upon his people. We pray for that moment, Father. And we pray that we will continue steadfast in our walks. Bless our families. Bless our churches. Bless our churches so that they too will hear this and receive it. We pray for the unity of Christ. We want to be close to one another. We need each other, Father. The enemy's against us. And if we're together, we are a formidable wall that the enemy cannot break if we're together. We give you glory. We give you honor. We praise you. We laud you. We worship you right now. We give you all the glory that you deserve. It's not about us. It's about you. And we pray, Father, that we will surrender ourselves as Jesus did. Humble ourselves and take on this spirit of servanthood. In Jesus' mighty name, may we all say, amen. 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 Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
That's a song that came to my heart just now as we were sitting here praying. It's victory in Jesus. It says, oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I think that's it for me.
Thank you.